The package you can provide includes a performance summary, which provides details on performance of individual managers, but I would just be providing some highlights on the pension performance during 2016. At year-end, the pension fund had a market value of $1.366 billion and achieved a return of 8.6%, which exceeds the target return of 7.5%. The fund benefited from strong performance in the real estate asset class, which had a one-year return of 13.7%, and domestic equities with return of 11.7%. Final numbers for a few of our alternative real estate managers have not been received, but those updates should have a minimal impact on the overall premium. MLGW's pension fund's performance ranked at the top 25% when compared to the universe of 60% public pension plans. And based on the market value as of December 31st, the pension fund had a funded ratio of 93.2%, making it one of the best funded pension plans in the country. In 2016, the division contributed 13.94% of its payroll to the pension fund, which is close to the 50-year average of 13%. This is down from 14.04% in 2015. You have any questions about the pension?
I just make a comment that we should all be very, very pleased that we've exceeded that 7.5%. And if you look around the country, where when Ann said we're 93.2% funded, if you read in the commercial appeal a couple of weeks ago, if you look at a city like Dallas, they're $5 billion underfunded. And I think you'll see that even the city of Memphis had some problems of being underfunded by a dramatic amount. So I think we're in very good stead right now in our pension, and hopefully we can keep it going.
We also have positive news for our OPEB trust, which is the other post-employment benefits trust. The market value for the OPEB as of December 31st is $343 million. The OPEB also outperformed its target return of 7.5%, achieving an 8.2% return per year. The OPEB benefited from strong performance in the domestic equity and fixed income asset classes. Domestic equities had a return of 11.2% and fixed income 7.8%. The OPEB's performance also ranked in the top 25% when compared to a universe of 57 plans. Currently, there is not a universe for OPEB funds, so the OPEB was compared to similar-sized public pension funds. As of December 31st, 2015, the funded ratio for the OPEB trust was 41.93%. We expect an increase in the funded ratio when we receive our actuarial report in a few months. We've been told our actuary is one of the best funded in the country. It's also notable that the pension fund and OPEB are so well funded, despite MLGW having the lowest combined utility rates of any major city in the country. Any questions regarding OPEB?
Thank you, Ann. Okay, let's get back to comments from the public. Michael Thompson.
Where do I go?
Go right up there. You have 3 minutes. Please state your name and address.
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, thank you for having us. My name is Michael Thompson. This is Margaret Ledbetter. We're both here to hear some complaints about the smart meters.
So, Michael, before you start, do you want to do your 3 minutes and then Margaret wants to do hers?
Yes.
Okay, great.
Okay.
That's
good.
Fine. I just wanted to know.
You betcha. I have some photographs to hand out, really just to pass along to the chairman and the members of the board. These deal with the installation of the smart meters. In my case, it was a gas meter, and in Ms. Ledbetter's case, it was an electric meter. Now, here are the photographs of my meter. Here, we just passed these out. And my invoice is from the plumbing company that had to come in and repair the damages of $6,100 in exchange for the damages caused by the air pressure, 30 pounds of air pressure being put through the system in an old house built in 1925. I've done a lot of research on this, talked to a lot of people that have had problems with the meters, the installation of the meters. In my case, the gas meter. Once it was installed right before Thanksgiving, we had 55 people at our home, family and relatives. As soon as they left, my wife smelled gas. I went outside, it was spewing out of that meter there right after it had been installed. Therefore, we had to call a plumber who had, and then Black Ass Water came and shut it off. That was during the week that we had 17-degree weather, so we had no heat. Now, we did move out. I'm not including any bills from the hotel bills. I'm not including that. The only thing I'm including in my bills are the plumbing cost to repair. And you'll see photographs of the pipes in our basement. Do you see the photographs, Mr. Chairman?
Okay. Yes, I do.
Those are just some of the places that caused the leaks. And every time a leak occurred, they had to shut the system back off and then re-thread a new pipe in its place and recall it, run the pressure again, and then the other leaks occurred. And so they were there for over a week. Two workmen and a supervisor for over a week. That's why it came to that much money. Now, I want to include, if I do have time, Mr. Chairman, you and I spoke briefly about this.
Yes,
you allowed me to come speak to the board, and you were interested in knowing about some of the cases around the country regarding smart meters. And I've gone to World Health Organization's website. You all should go there and see what they have to say, especially about the electromagnetic waves. And you may poo-poo that, but they are affecting pacemakers. And one of my friends that you know has opted out of the program because he has a pacemaker, and it will shock him and set it off. And there are already lawsuits around the country regarding the electromagnetic fields. Here are the articles on those. Also with fires and damages, the smart meters after they've been installed. This is occurring all over the United States. I only wish, in concluding my remarks, two things, that you would reimburse me and Ms. Ledbetter for our expenses. We have not, as yet, done anything else, and we don't intend to. We just like to be reimbursed. If we need to sign release forms saying we would not speak of this publicly or to any media or anyone else upon signing of a release, if we're reimbursed, we shall do so. We'll sign a release. Now, there are lawsuits occurring all over the United States. My only wish is that as your mission statement says, and I've researched this, I've even read the proposal that was made by Apex to install a system for $240 million, that your number one mission is your customers. My only question then, going forward, not beyond my case is, it is what it is going forward for the customers of Memphis, why not have it be an opt-in program instead of an opt-out? We never received a notice. We never received an automated phone call. We had been out of town when that letter came, and we have lots of mail that comes through our home, and we never saw the opt-out option. Thank you.
So before you leave,
I want to stay.
Okay, you can stay, and I just have, before I turn it over to the president and ask anybody else any questions, you said 30 pounds of pressure caused the, and when you spoke to me, I didn't know anything about this, I still don't understand.
That's the ICL fuel regulation.
Okay, so you said that 30 pounds of pressure was applied to your gas lines that caused a lot of the leaks, is that what you were saying?
Yes, which never would have occurred had the smart meter never been put on. It started leaking and spewing the day it was put on.
But my question is, who was the smart meter, the gas, I'll ask the president or somebody, was that MLG&W that put the 30 pounds of pressure?
No, they can't do that. They don't do that. None of the utilities or distributors do that. Your plumber does that. But MLG&W requires that it be done according to the International Fuel Code of 30 pounds, okay? So it's an old house, and that's the issue. The newer houses are not having these problems. The older houses need to be an opt-in program, not an opt-out.
Yeah, but, well, whether it's an opt-in or opt-out program, I guess what I'm trying to understand is, would these leaks have shown up anyway?
No, I don't know. I've had it because it's been that way. We've been living in the house for 25 years. We hadn't had any problems until that happened. No problems. No leaks.
So
putting the meter on is what started the cascade is the problem.
So what did your plumber say about this? I mean, when he tested it, why did he put so much pressure on it? Was that required?
That's required.
I'm sorry?
That is required.
Oh, once you turn the gas back on?
Yes, it's required by the International Fuel Code System, I believe it's called. Jared, is that what it's called?
International Gas Fuel Code.
International Gas Fuel Code. That's, every distributor and every utility has to go by that.
So this is not an UGMW requirement?
No, it's an International Fuel Code issue. Everyone has to put the 30 pounds of pressure in it, and what it's doing is it's affecting the older houses that have just been sealed and tight, nothing's happening. When you put, it's a 4 ounce gas system, folks. That's what goes through our system, 4 ounces of gas pressure. So now you're running 30 pounds of air pressure through to check for leaks, and it's in old houses that it's occurring in the gas system. Ms. Ledbetter is a different situation. Hers is electric.
Well, we'll talk about the electric.
Oh, it's the gas right now. And he was spewing out where we could hear it. When I came around the corner of the back of my house, I could hear it hissing.
So the smart meter was put on, and so how did the pressure get tested? They just replaced your meter.
When Apex put the meter on, we weren't even aware of it, okay? We found out it was like 2 days before Thanksgiving. And as soon as everyone left that Friday, we smelled, smelled gas, and I could hear it hissing before I got around the corner from here to that tree out there. From the meter, I could hear it hissing. And I got up to it and it was just hissing out, okay? At the coupling, at the, where the coupling.
The meter didn't cause that, did it?
Putting the meter on just caused it, yes. Not the meter itself, but the act of putting the meter on. My understanding is that Apex is paid to install as many of these as fast as possible. And you're only about 5 or 6% of Shelby County residents right now, okay? Of installation, and not including the commercial, which will start in 2018. So you're going to get through the residential by 2018 and start in commercial. Now, I feel like you're going to see a lot more problems and lawsuits unless something is done. And in my case, I'd just like to be reimbursed. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
What's your total?
$6,127. It's on that first page of the plumbing invoices.
That's a total.
Yes.
And that's a total of not just fixing the one piece around where the smart meter went on until they came, your plumber tested it, and then everything started going off.
Those are plumbing bills.
I've got a 104-year-old house myself, and it hasn't started here. It hasn't had any problems.
Well, good for you. Looking forward to it.
Well, I'm going to turn it over to unless anybody else has any comments or questions, I'm going to turn it over to President and his team to work on this.
My trusty assistant is Aubrey King, and Aubrey is a gas meter expert. And each of the board members has a timeline and a folder at her chair. And Aubrey's going to assist me and give you information above and beyond my expertise. The Apex contractor actually installed the gas smart meter on October the 27th of 2016. And in doing so, he turned the gas off and he left it off. Because this is a larger gas meter than usual at Mr. Thompson's house. And so you want to explain what transpired after the Apex contractor?
Certainly. Mr. Thompson has a 2 PSI delivery system. Okay. Standard is a quarter pound. When you need a larger amount of gas, we do have 2 PSI delivery. Okay. Because of that, we cannot change the meter hot because there's too much pressure. There's an apparatus that we use so that we can not disturb the gas service as long as you're using the standard quarter pound delivery. When you go to 2 pound delivery, I can't use that. It's too much pressure, it blows it out. Okay, so 2 PSI like Mr. Thompson has, I have to shut the gas off and actually change the meter, and then we'll have to go back and light appliances. Okay, when that's done, if everything checks out fine, gas services are stored. But if it's not, then we have to refer them to a contractor to have their repairs made. And that requires them getting a permit and an air test. Standard procedure for anybody that has a problem.
So.
But why do you have to put in that 30 pounds?
We didn't put in the 30 pounds. And let me.
I understand you didn't, but why is that, like in an older house, why do you have to put so much pressure?
Let's get to that in a minute.
Okay.
So after Apex turned the gas off, put the meter in, then we followed that up with a visit from a MLGW crew. And what did the MLGW crew do at that point?
They relit the equipment in Mr. Thompson's.
After turning the gas back on?
After turning the gas on, you check everything at the meter center, make sure that there are no visible leaks from the meter center. Then they go inside and they check equipment and light it if it's okay. And on this trip right here, on November the 1st, that was the T-17 order, okay? Gas was turned on and everything was fine. All right?
Okay, then that takes us to November the 28th. On November the 28th, we got a call that there was a gas odor, and we went to the house, and that's when we had a gas leak inside the house at the stove.
Correct.
So that had been there for quite some time, a very minor leak that had been under our stove for two or three years, not bothering us.
So that was a pre-existing leak, and did we fix that with our forces, or how did that transpire?
From what I understand, it was fixed by our tech when he went in, repaired the leak, and gas was left on at that time. Okay?
So then the same day, we get a call about a leak at the meter, which was hissing and spewing. And when a gas leak is hissing and spewing, that means it's a relatively small leak. If it's not making any noise, then it's a big leak. All right. So when you went to fix the gas leak at the meter, did we turn the gas off?
No. All that was done was the nut here was tightened up and the leak was stopped.
No, it kept leaking.
According to what my information is, the leak was repaired and the gas was left on.
Why did we have to have the plumber come out then and undo and check the leaks? And the system.
There was a subsequent event which occurred on December the 12th. On December the 12th, there was a complaint of a gas odor at the meter. So we went out on that occasion, and what did we find?
On the 12th, at the gas meter, no leak was found, but the customer has equipment in their basement, and there's an exhaust that's coming out of the basement, okay? And they found what you would find in an exhaust. Carbon monoxide was coming out, but there was also a 2% amount of gas that was coming out with it. So the tech went inside, checked all the equipment, found leaks, and at that point, we couldn't get it to where we could isolate the leak, so you have to shut the meter off, okay? At that point again, we're saying you need to get a licensed contractor to make repairs before we can turn the gas back on. And that's what happened at that time, the gas was left off.
Mr. Chairman, none of my invoices there reflect the HVAC repair on that furnace that you said had CO2, carbon monoxide, I mean, and it was vented to the outside of the house. So none of the bills that I'm presenting today had anything to do with the furnace, with what you're saying. It might only have to do with the basement. Look at the photographs, if you don't mind. Those are the repairs showing you the new threading of pipes that sometimes will just be this long to fix a leak there, then go shred, re-thread it and put it on and do all that. And they had to do it for, I think a week and a half or so. I did ask Mr. Collins about it in an email, and I did receive an email from him basically saying, it's not our problem. And in essence, you owe another additional $150 for the gas bill that we found. And that's fine, we paid that. We didn't have any problems with that. We paid the additional gas bill. But there was not a phone number on the email, Mr. Collins, and I wrote you back asking you, why would you include a phone number so I might be able to call you?
Citizens call me all day long, every day. I'm very accessible. So when we fixed this leak, we did not turn the gas off, and this leak was fixed, and it was better than 2 weeks later when they called with the gas odor that they said was coming from the meter, but the gas odor was actually not coming from the meter at all. It was coming from the piping in the basement. So the question then is how did the smart meter or the installation of the smart meter cause gas leaks in the basement?
30 pounds of pressure, sir.
We didn't apply 30 pounds of pressure.
But after you put the meter on, there were leaks and it required the pressure. You just mentioned it. You just said the installation of the smart meter caused the cascade. He had already said yes that day. He shook his head and said, yeah, it started cascading after that with all the
pressure. That's not correct.
Yes, sir, it is. It's the installation of the smart meter. The smart meter itself didn't cause the leaks. It's the apex when you're not installer that caused it.
I think you ought to take this and talk about this somewhere else.
Okay.
And try to work this out with Mr. Thompson and whoever your team is and discuss it.
Okay.
Because I don't think we're going to resolve anything right now. It's going to go back and forth, and I got to hear what this legislator has to say.
I understand, and my point is I just want the board to understand that the installation of a smart meter on the exterior of a home does not cause the piping to leak inside the home.
Have we had any alerts about somewhere we went?
Oops, sir. Not of this nature, no, sir.
When we installed more than 50,000 gas smart meters.
I
thought the other people had been wrong with that.
Michael, will you talk to offline, I guess offline, with
sure,
Jerry and their and sure, his team?
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Ms. Ledbetter, please tell us. Please state your name, address, and you have 3 minutes. And
Thank you, Mr. Collins and the board. I'm Margaret Ledbetter, live at 395 Goodwin. I am nowhere nearly as prepared as Mr. Thompson was.
You got a meter?
Pardon? We did have an incident, it was on Halloween 2016, where an individual who identified himself as an LGNW, he was there to check my meter. I was at home, it was in the morning. We do have 2 meters at our home because we have a guest house garage that's a separate piece of property. Saw them out there, they were spending an abnormally long amount of time together out there and asked, but in my kitchen, about 10 minutes later, all the power went out. And I went outside and said, hey, everything okay? And he said, I do not know if this was an MLGW or a contractor. I do not know. He had the same vest on. He looked very similar to our regular.
Good looking guy.
It's a great looking guy. And he said, I'm sorry, ma'am, your meter burned up. I gotta go. And I said, well, hold on. I'm here. Do I need to call the fire department? And he said, I gotta go. I'll get back to you. And I said, well, how long till I have power? I need some power. He said, give me 1 hour and you'll have power back. Let's see. This was Halloween day, and I did have some errands to run. I got home at 1, and that all happened about 9:45. I got home at 1, and there was a notice on my door that someone had come by, and I'll give you a copy. I don't have a number of copies of this, but it did say that the MLGW would provide an electrician, that the electric meter socket was damaged and burned, the weatherhead eye bolt or entrance cable mast was damaged, the entrance cable was damaged, frayed, and burned. The meter socket needs to be replaced. MLGW has contacted an electrician. So, do you want this? I'll give it to you. We appreciate the notice. I waited till about 3 o'clock when I rang Carpool. I haven't heard anything back. I did try to contact MLGW, and we've had nothing but lovely service from MLGW, but they would not speak to me on the phone because the account is in my husband's name.
Oh.
So they wouldn't give me any information. At 3:30, an electrician did arrive, and he said, oh, this meter is a mess. And I do not have a photograph of it, but the glass panel on the outside was completely smoked. So that's all I know. Whether that was the new meter or the old meter, I honestly don't know. He said he had to go gather materials, so this was going to be an ordeal for repair.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please.
So I guess I'm clear.
Please.
Was it the meter that burned up, or was it the socket that burned?
Well, that is way above you. My pay grade. I will tell you the individual.
Because you said the meter
was
burned.
The individual who was there said, ma'am, your meter burned up.
That was the old meter.
I have to, you know.
That's fine, I just wanted to find out what was.
I do too. We went to, at 5 o'clock, we still had no power. We happened to go to an event where Councilman Spinoza was, and we gave him just the quick flip notes about what was going on. And he said, well, let me get back to you.
So it was a socket difference, right?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay, so you.
Well, it was a socket, not the meter.
Okay. From what I understood, the meter burned out. We didn't get anybody back at the house till about 3 a.m. that morning. And at that point, I know MLGW trucks were there. I'm not sure if it was MLGW and a contractor or just MLGW or just, I know there was an MLGW truck. There were probably four trucks. They did a good bit of work and we did get the power back on. So we were grateful for that. However, as soon as the power was restored, we realized our HVAC system did not come back on and our refrigerator was making a constant beep. So we had someone come evaluate the HVAC system. We could not get it started up. And they confirmed that the HVAC system had been severely damaged by a major power surge. I don't think that that is a coincidence. We had had in February 2016, we had a full service of our HVAC unit by Boy May, and everything was, we replaced everything that looked in trouble. It was in fine working order until this incident. I do have some photographs. There were signs of smoke damage on the unit. The wires were melted. The relay was fried. The fan motor was completely black. And the individual that we spoke to, and this is through Belfort, said this is just entirely too much power moving to the system. That's the information that we got. We did communicate with MLGW, and they sent some lovely individuals. Mr. Theodore Washington, Mr. Philip Cox arrived to evaluate the system. They spent an enormous amount of time interviewing my workmen and myself and my husband. And we walked through the home and we showed exactly where the damage had happened. We gave them the estimate for the repairs. They said, we'll get back to you. Please save everything. So we've saved everything. Until this week, we have very little luck hearing back from them. But this week, we've heard back from Mr. Washington, and we do not have our final bills. We did have an estimate of $16,000 to replace our HVAC system. We just got the inspection completed on it on Tuesday, and we are awaiting the final bill. And the only thing that we would like is to be reimbursed. And that's an enormous amount of money for us at this point. That was completely unnecessary in my mind.
So my question is, President, so if the socket was burned up, our procedure is that we do replace sockets, correct?
No.
Am I wrong in that?
We're going to kind of help explain how all this works with this together. This is Tony Wilson.
Tony Wilson, Sean.
And they work on electric meters. And basically, what happened on that day, and the picture I gave you of the meter itself, that's
sure, please.
And so, you know, MLGW owns the meter,
right?
And the homeowner owns the socket,
right?
And so when the Apex guy pulls the old meter out of the right clip was burnt.
Correct.
And we have a picture of that, and we'll show that to the sled there. It's that clip right there.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that was burnt. And what else was burnt besides the clip?
Also, the wire, entrance wire itself was burnt where it made the connection at the clip. So all that was burnt when he pulled the meter. And so we had to immediately stop. That's what we train them to do. And find something that's a dangerous situation, they have to stop.
Wait, I'm sorry. This was a dangerous situation?
Yes.
Nobody said that to me, and I was in that home.
It's because it's burnt.